All of you wanting to learn about accounting. Welcome to this video. Today I will illustrate the fundamentals of accounting by showing the importance of the balance sheet, namely the asset part of it. The video will guide you with examples, assuming the existence of a printing company named Fast Print. Don't forget to share this video with a friend that it's eager to learn as much as you. Are you ready? Let's go. John, a young entrepreneur, spotted a business opportunity in the city center downtown, a place where many shops and businesses compete using marketing techniques, where they have a need for brochures, leaflets, flyers, and handouts. As he's a self-learner, he decided to buy accounting books to educate himself. John is now reading about the balance sheet. The balance sheet, it's a financial statement that shows the amount of a company's assets, liabilities, and shareholders' or owners' equity at a given moment. You can look at the balance sheet as a picture of a company's financial position at a certain moment. I mean, as a certain moment because it reflects a precise point in time, rather than a period of time. This is actually one of the differences between the balance sheet and the income statement. For example, if a balance sheet is dated as December 31st, the amounts indicated on the balance sheet are the balances in the accounts after all December 31st transactions have been recorded. Let's review in more detail the assets section. An asset is a resource with economic value that a corporation owns or controls with the expectation that it will provide a future benefit. Assets are bought or created to increase a firm's value or benefit the firm's operations. There is an expectation when owning an asset that in the future he can generate cash flow, reduce expenses, or improve sales. In a simplistic mode, assets are items that a corporation has and are frequently referred to as the firm's resources. After an initial confusion, John grasps this meaning by associating items like the company's van, cash in the bank, all of the supplies he has on hand, the printing machinery and desktop that he needs for designing. However, there's a catch. If John provides the service to a customer, but isn't paid right away, the sum due to Fast Print becomes an asset known as accounts receivable. However, let's now add to the situation the fact that Fast Print pays a premium on February 1st for the usage of a design software service for 12 months. This is commonly known as a prepaid expense. A prepaid expense is an asset on the balance sheet that results from a business making advanced payments for goods or services to be received in the future. Prepaid expenses are initially recorded as assets, but their value is expensed over time onto the income statement. Goods or services of this nature cannot be expensed immediately because the expense would not match with the benefit incurred over time from using the asset. So, adding numbers to the situation, let's say Fast Print has paid $600 for the usage of the design software service for 12 months, starting on February 1st. This equals to a monthly expense of $50, 600 divided by 12. In February, Fast Print will use his $50 and will charge it to the income statement under the account IT software account. The remaining $550 will remain in the balance sheet assets section under prepaid account. John starts to rationalize the connection between the income statement and the balance sheet. As he keeps on reading, he discovers that each of his company's assets were recorded at their original cost, and that even if the fair market value of an item rises, an accountant will not adjust the reported amount of that asset on the balance sheet. This is due to the cost concept, which is another fundamental accounting theory. Although accountants do not typically raise the value of an asset, they may reduce its value due to a notion called as conservatism. Let's say that John, for the sake of providing a faster service, decides to storage more paper than usual, and he anticipates a certain level of stock. In order to have access to wholesale discounts, he manages to buy at 5 cents per paper. However, a couple of months after, the market price drops 20% to 4 cents. If the net realizable value of his inventory is less than the initial recorded cost, the accountant must declare the lesser amount as the asset's value on the balance sheet. In summary, the cost principle typically prohibits assets from being reported at a value greater than their cost, whereas conservatism may require assets to be reported at a value less than their cost. John, it's by now completely focused on the reading, so he continues to the next topic, depreciation. Depreciation is the process of allocating an asset's cost to depreciation expense on the income statement throughout its useful life. The matching principle, a fundamental accounting concept, requires depreciation. Depreciation is applied to assets that have a finite life, as for example, equipment wears out, cars become too old and expensive to maintain, buildings age, and certain assets, such as computers, become outdated. For example, assume that Fast Print has a van, which in turn has a useful life of 5 years, and was purchased at a cost of $25,000. The accountant might match $5,000 of depreciation expense, which is $25,000 divided by 5 years, with each year's revenues for 5 years. Subsequently, on each year, the carrying amount of the van, which is reported on the balance sheet, will be reduced by $5,000, until after 5 years, its carrying amount will be zero. This will be the end of the van's expected useful life. Long-term assets, such as buildings, equipment, and furnishings, are reported at their cost minus the amounts already sent to the income statement as depreciation expense. As a result, while the market value of a building may have grown since its acquisition, the amount on the balance sheet has continually decreased as the accountant transferred some of its cost to depreciation expense on the income statement in order to meet the matching principle. By contrast, another asset as office equipment may have a substantially lower fair market value than the carrying amount represented on the balance sheet. Generally speaking, short-term asset levels are likely to be near to their market values, as depreciation is not seen as a valuation procedure by accountants, but as an allocation process between costs, expenses, and revenues generated by the asset. John realizes now of an important learning that he should keep in mind the next time he reads a balance sheet. The balance sheet only shows the assets bought at the price stated in the transaction. As we get to the end of this video, let me know on the comment section below if you now understand how depreciation may differ from real market value of equipments and buildings. I want you to know that it was great to do this video, and if you have enjoyed, want to keep on learning and still did not subscribe to the channel, today is the perfect day to do so by clicking on the subscribe button below. Thanks for watching and I will see you again soon.